Hello everyone, welcome to the GOA Ecologist. I'm Dr. Krishnanand and you have been watching my series on oceanography. So in this session on oceanography, we are going to learn about the temperature distribution, its various factors, the factors controlling these temperature distributions across the globe and several other parts of it. But before we go ahead, don't forget to subscribe to our channel and do share the videos with others as well. So now let's learn about the ocean's temperature distribution, various factors, and various other aspects related to temperature all across the globe, across the oceans. So the study of ocean's temperature as a subject matter in marine meteorology begins since the time of Matthew Fontaine Maury. Now remember this name, M.F. Maury, who was part of US Navy, who's also regarded as founder of scientific marine meteorology. That is important to remember. And he was also nicknamed Pathfinder of the Seas, father of modern oceanography and naval meteorology. So he is the person, M.F. Maury, who in his extensive works, in his book, that is The Physical Geography of the Sea, right in 1855, remember, 1850s were the time when isostasy was also being studied, right? Mid-Atlantic oceanic ridge was also being studied. So 1850s, or we can say, second half of 19th century was a great time for oceanographers. So this is when it was all discovered and many things were coming up. The new important knowledge was coming up. So this was important, in which measuring the ocean's temperature was one of the features. That is important to remember. That's why Matthew Fontaine Maury is regarded as the scientist of the seas, or you can say father of modern oceanography as well. So that is where the study starts, right? So now let's understand that what is this ocean's temperature? What are its controlling factors? How we measure it? So all these things, let's understand. So first question is, how do we measure the temperature of oceans? Now it is important to understand the method of measurement. So there are three types of temperature measuring devices. So what are the three types? First one is called accurate thermometer. Now the word itself is accuracy. So it is accurate thermometer and it is of the standard type, basically employed for the measuring of surface temperature. So remember, accuracy is about the surface temperature only. So remember, sea surface temperature is also called SST. So accuracy or accurate thermometers or the standard thermometers are used for SSTs. Then is the reversing type of this thermometer. So what are these? The thermometers used for measuring temperatures at subsurface levels. Now here is the catch, that it is not SST, it is now subsurface, within the surface. That is important. And the third one is basically the temperature measuring instruments that give a continuous record. Now the important catch here is this continuous record point, and they are called thermographs. Now remember, this is the third type called thermographs, and what is the key feature here? It gives us the continuous measurement which are employed at shore stations. Now remember, these are important points to remember in the measurement devices, that this is employed not under the water, this is at the shore stations, and onboard vessels are there to record the temperature, and further they are fixed at a particular level near the sea surface. So this is the third type called thermographs. Now the next important question is, why do we need to measure the temperature of oceans? What is the need? So the sea surface temperature or ocean temperature, that we say, it plays a vital role. In what? In understanding the influence of global climatic change, and which is in relation to what? Influencing global radiation balance, heat budget, and several others. Then the next important point is, the thermal conditions of the ocean water determine the control of these planetary winds. Now this is important point, that remember, we have already learned all of this in the climatology lectures. So if you have not watched the primary winds and their functions and how they move, and remember the pressure belts and temperature belts, you can go to the playlist on my channel, that is in the climatology. We have already discussed these points, right? So the temperature of seawater also affects the weather and climate of coastal areas, that also we already know, right? Through diurnal rhythm of land and sea breeze, evaporation, moisture conditions. So this is what we have already discussed in climatology as well, right? So this is the overlap between oceanography and climatology. And since the seawater has a high specific heat, now remember, it has a higher specific heat than comparison to the land. Basically, it means what? It has higher heat storage capacity. So
its heating and cooling process are much slower than that on the land. So it cools very slowly as well as it heats very slowly. That is important to remember in comparison to the land. So what happens? The oceans have higher storage capacity of the heat. That is what is important to remember. So sea surface temperature plays a vital role in what? In making the global hydrological cycle functional. So remember, the hydrological cycle will not be functional if the oceans have anomalies in temperature distribution. That is why we are worried when we are talking about global climatic changes, and that is where the ocean temperature is being affected. We are talking about global warming, right? Anomalies. So this is why we are concerned here. Then salinity and density, again these two important points which we are going to discuss in the lectures to come as well in details, are important in terms of ocean water, which are closely linked with temperature. So there is a close link of salinity, temperature and density. So remember these factors, that is salinity, density and temperature, they are interlinked. That is important, and in details we are going to discuss in the sessions to come as well. And solar energy received at water surfaces of the oceans help in what? In the photosynthesis by phytoplanktons, and thus sea temperature becomes very important also for zooplanktons. Now remember, phytoplanktons are the plants and zooplanktons are the animals. That is what we say, right? So phytoplankton's growth will automatically enhance the zooplankton's growth in a particular zone, which we also say is the littoral zone, right? Where the sunlight percolates or it goes inside the ocean. So that is important to remember as an ecological principle. The food that we derive, right? That is also dependent in many aspects from this temperature of the oceans. That is why we are concerned about it. Now let's elaborate further more. So when we talk about the distribution of temperature, very famously this graph always comes into the picture. Now remember, what is this in this? There is this depth. So we see there is increasing depth. And then what we have is the increasing temperature on one axis. So what do you observe? Around 25 degrees C, you see this particular mark, and this is a 500 mark and this is a 1000 mark. So remember, about 300 mark, this starts to actually go down here, right? And then quickly it descends, and then again it gains stability and quickly descends on this line. So this is what we say is a particular line where temperature of the ocean in terms of verticality with depth, it has been discussed, right? So we are also going to learn about horizontal distribution as well as vertical distribution. This area between 300 to 1000 meters is called thermocline, where you have sharp line there, right? So let's elaborate that horizontal distribution basically means surface distribution. Vertical distribution means with depth, what is the distribution, right? So if we see three-dimensional shape, this is the particular diagram that we need to understand, that with depth, how it changes, right? So that is important to remember. The next important point is the factors affecting distribution of temperature of ocean water. So what are the factors? The first factor is latitudes. And why latitudes? Remember the distribution of solar insolation, which we have already learned in the climatology lectures. So insolation is direct on equator, and gradually it slants down and distributes on a larger area as we go towards pole. So basically means what? The tropical zone, right? This particular zone between 0 to 30 or 40 degree north and south receives maximum insolation, isn't it? So this area will have more energy and hence more temperature, isn't it? So that's why latitudinal distribution is important in terms of receiving solar insolation. So what we observe here is that from 40 north to 40 south, about 40 north to 40 south, this zone. So in this particular zone, the temperature of surface water, now remember we are talking about sea surface temperature, this temperature between 40 degree and 40 degree south, between 40 degree north and 40 degree south, is lower than the air temperature. This is the first point to remember. Between 40 north and 40 south, here the sea surface temperature, SST, is lower. It means air temperature is more because of the higher insulation and also because of the availability of land area and the ocean distribution that we already know, right? But as we go beyond 40th latitude, beyond this area, what starts to happen towards pole in both the hemisphere? The air cools faster. The upper surface air cools faster, but the water cools gradually, as we already know about the property of the water, right? So water is warmer in comparison to the air across this 40 degree to 90 degree poles, right? That is important point to remember, that from 40 north to 40 south, what is the feature? The water temperature and air temperature have a distinction. In what ways? In 40 north and 40 south, the air temperature is more, it is greater, right, than the water temperature. But as you cross this 40 and go towards the pole, the air temperature is cooler and water temperature is warmer in relativeness. That is important, and that is because of the latitudinal heat balance that we have already learned in the climatology lectures. Then the second point is the unequal distribution of land and water. Right now we were only talking about the distribution of land and water, that also is different in different hemisphere. So what we have here is the ocean temperature in northern and southern hemisphere vary, right, because of this distribution, right? So what you see in northern hemisphere, we have a dominance of land, right, while in southern hemisphere we have dominance of ocean. So if you observe, land hemisphere is the northern hemisphere where 61% water is there, but if you see the southern hemisphere, it has 81% water. So this is what is the difference. So the oceans in northern hemisphere receive more heat due to their contact with the larger extent of land. While what happens? Just the opposite in the southern hemisphere, right? Because there is no land area as much, right? So the temperatures of the ocean water are independent of the land factor. So what happens? The temperature of surface, so sea surface temperature, is comparatively higher in the former, that is northern hemisphere, than latter. So higher temperatures in northern hemisphere, reason is that more land area, they get heated up quickly, and so you have the transfer of energy, and that's why you have more energy or more temperature in the northern hemisphere. So for example, if you observe the average annual temperature of surface water at equator, it is 26.7 degrees C, right? Whereas it is 37.8 degrees C in the Red Sea and 34.4 degrees C in the Persian Gulf. Now here, if you observe from equator, if you go towards the Red Sea or Persian Gulf, right, then what is the temperature? It has increased, right? That is what we see. So in tropics, you have the maximum warming, then comes the nature of land and water. And when we say nature, it is simply that factor which we have already learned in climatology, that is albedo factor, that is reflection factor, how much the land keeps or how much it releases out, right? So contrasting nature of this land and water, that is their property, impacts the spatial distribution of temperature. So what you observe here is that the reflection, that is albedo of incoming solar radiation from the oceanic water, is far more than that from the land surface. And thus what happens? If you have more reflection, it means you don't have much energy there, right? So water receives less insulation than land. It doesn't keep, it reflects much of it from the surface. So this is important, and also cloudiness factor becomes one of the most important factor in contrast to land and water. Why? Because where there is more water surface, more cloud formation happens. And remember, cloud also absorbs while it also obstructs, right? So both the factors are there. So land surface does not have much of cloud cover, right? But ocean surface also has cloud cover. That also impacts the amount of insulation, and that's why the temperature variation is there in ocean. So now let's understand this fourth factor, that is the prevailing wind factor. Now in prevailing wind, we understand the two important points here. One is called offshore winds and the other is called onshore winds. Now remember this offshore and onshore. Offshore, the word itself says, it is away from the shore. So what is this? The land towards the oceans and seas. So winds are going from land to the sea, right? So when winds are going from land to sea, automatically the word is offshore, and it will do what? It will drive warm surface water away from the coast. So when there is a land area and this is an ocean area and the wind is coming like this, this particular ocean area, the wind will try and drive away this temperature which is there in the ocean. Just opposite happens when the wind is onshore. It is coming from the ocean and it is going to the land, right? So what happens basically? There is the replacement of warm water by cold water, and it introduces longitudinal variation in temperature that we see along the longitudes, right? So contrary to this, when there is onshore, we have already learned what? That if it is onshore, it is coming from the ocean to the land, right? So what happens here? It piles up warm water near the coast. So remember, if it is onshore, it will be warmer near the coast, near the land. If it is offshore, it will be cooler near the coast. This is important to remember. Offshore, cool near coast. Onshore, warm near coast, right? So for example, if you want to see, the trade winds cause low temperature in tropics, where along the eastern margins of the oceans or the western coastal regions of the continents because they blow from land towards the ocean. So very simple, if it is blowing from land towards the ocean, it will lower the temperature, right? But just opposite what happens, whereas these trade winds raise the temperature in the western margins of the oceans or the eastern coastal area of the continents because of their onshore position. So remember, if it is onshore, the temperature will rise. If it is offshore, it will drive away the temperature. So this way you can remember the influence of prevailing winds. Then the fifth point is your ocean currents. So what is this ocean current now? Remember, separately also we'll learn about ocean currents, waves and tides. But for here, in terms of temperature distribution, remember that ocean currents are like rivers flowing in the ocean, right? And in what ways? From equator, they carry water towards the pole, and from pole, they again come back to equator. So remember, from equator, when they go towards the pole, what will happen? Automatically, they will carry the warmer waters to the colder oceans. And from polar area when they come, they will carry colder water or cooler water to the warmer areas. So this is what happens, and that's why the temperature regulation happens. So warm currents raise the temperature automatically, whereas cool currents lower down the temperature. For example, the Gulf Stream. Remember, the Gulf Stream, if you observe this particular map, this is the Gulf Stream, right? This area, right? So this is the eastern United States, if you see. So this raises the temperature near the eastern coast of North America and western coast of Europe. Remember, this western coast of Europe, this particular area, the Gulf Stream raises the temperature. Kuroshio, remember, this is Kuroshio near Japan. So this particular area is again warmed up, right, in the eastern coast of Asia and raises the temperature near Alaska. So this portion there, you have the rise in temperature. While on the other hand, if you see Labrador cool current, where is Labrador? Remember this particular eastern margin and southern Greenland, this area, Labrador. So this area brings cooler water. So automatically there will be cool temperatures of the ocean. That's what the important point here is. And similarly, temperature of eastern coast of Siberia becomes low due to Kuril cool current. So here, Oeshu and Kuril current, remember, this area will have cooler temperatures. So ocean currents also are the major factors that lead to the differentials or temperature distributions across these latitudes. Then comes the smaller factors or minor factors. What are these factors? Submarine ridges, local weather conditions like storm, cyclone, hurricane, fog, cloudiness, evaporation, condensation, and several other features like location and shape of the sea. These are the minor features that also influence the sea surface temperature. Remember, these are the minor features, but they do have an influence. So if you observe longitudinally, more extensive seas in the lower latitudes have higher temperature. We are talking about lower latitude, basically 0 to about 23.5, that is the tropics part, or we can say up to 30 degree. So these areas have longitudinally more extensive seas and have higher temperature. So if you observe, the Mediterranean records higher temperature than Gulf of California. So this is the Mediterranean Sea, which has higher temperature than Gulf of California, which is here, right? So remember why this happens, because of this extensive sea and also the land area, which is here covered, right? And this is according to the longitudinal direction that we say, right? So this is important to remember. While if you see enclosed seas in the lower latitudes record relatively higher temperature. So if they are enclosed, automatically you understand that there is a continentality in the picture. It means land area all across is heated up, right? So for example, if you observe, the Baltic Sea records 0 degree, that is what you say, 32 degree Fahrenheit, and open seas have 4.4 degree C or 40 degree F at the same lower latitude. That is important to remember. Now, if we compare the latitudinal distribution of these enclosed seas, remember, enclosed seas in low latitudes, in the lower latitudes, that is close to equator, in this particular zone in tropics, the enclosed seas have higher temperature than the open seas. But what happens to the same kind of enclosure seas in the higher latitudes? They reverse. Remember, the Baltic Sea, it has 0 degree C temperature in comparison to the open seas all around it. That is what we understand. In higher latitudes, the enclosed seas have lesser temperature. Now let's talk about the horizontal distribution of ocean's temperature. So what is this horizontal distribution? We are talking about a seasonal distribution in which we are looking at particular temperature isotherms, right, all across the world. So isotherms are what? These are the lines joining the places of same temperature. So the seasonal temperatures of Earth's surface, including both land and ocean sea surfaces, are shown through isotherms, that is of January and July. Remember, two types of isotherms. One is the winter, one is the summer. So January and July, right? So what happens? The sun moves towards the northern hemisphere and it reaches this Tropic of Cancer on 21st June, right? So it means the maximum insolation is received in the northern hemisphere during the summers, that is June, July time, right? So that is where sea surface temperature increases. But during January, what you observe, the sea surface temperature is higher on this particular ocean, on the southern ocean, right? So this is what we say is the fluctuation of insolation. And similarly, there is a fluctuation in the isotherms as well. That is important to remember. Let's observe this isotherm representing horizontal distribution of temperatures in July. So now what you observe during July, as we know, that sun is moving towards the northern portion, right? Sun is shining overhead here on Cancer and nearby Cancer. So this particular area has more surface temperature, that is close to 30 degrees, and the other areas have lesser temperature, right? So this is what you need to remember, that surface temperatures are different in different seasons, and this is what we talk about when we map them through isotherms. Now looking at the vertical distribution of ocean temperature. Now remember, there is this maximum temperature of the oceans in particular depth that we understand, right? So oceans are vertically divided into two zones, right? And photic zone is the first zone. Photic, the word is photons, it means light is penetrating and up to a depth of about 200 meters. This area receives maximum solar insolation, and that's why more of warming or more of temperature is there in this particular zone. While there is aphotic zone, and that is below 200 meter depth, right, where there is less penetration or virtually no penetration of the sun's rays. So what happens there? The temperature is automatically lesser, it is cooler. So if you observe this particular graph, remember this is depth in meters, so 183, 366, and gradually when you're going down, what is the temperature? Temperature is higher on the surface, and as you go down, it starts to go down. Why? Because the upper surface receives more insulation, and that's why it is heated up, right? That's the important point to remember. Then let's compare the temperature of sea surface at different depth. So according to latitude, if you see 0 to 10, 10 to 20, 20 to 30, 30 to 40, this is latitudinal extent. And look at the surface temperature at each latitude. So 0 to 10, it is about 27. Then from 20 to 30, it is again 23.9. And then as you go towards the pole, it starts to dip. So higher temperature are there in the tropical, that we already know, right? So this is a data suggesting the same. And vertically, the oceans are divided into three layers. And remember, these three layers are upper layer, lower layer, and also the transitional zone. So if you observe the upper layer, the warm mass or warm water is there in the upper layer, right? Which was part of the other classification as photic zone, right? So here the temperature is 20 degrees C to 25 degrees C, while the lower area, which is beyond 1000 meter, right, that area has very cold temperatures. That is important to remember. While the intermediate zone, this particular zone between 300 to about 1000 meters, this area is called thermocline, where there is this sharp decrease in temperature. This zone of sharp decrease is called thermocline. So this is important to remember. And there are seasonal thermoclines as well. So these seasonal thermoclines vary between the depth of 40 to 100 meters. And remember, these seasonal thermoclines are formed due to heating of water surface through solar radiation during summer season. So seasonal variation is there. Diurnal changes are there. So there is diurnal thermocline as well. And remember, diurnal thermocline form where in the shallow water zone, that is about 10 to 15 meters deep only. So thermocline is an area which is transition area between the top surface photic zone and the bottom deep area, that is aphotic zone. Apart from this temperature distribution, there are some anomalous cases also on the Earth's surface. And these are the areas which have high temperature in greater depth. Now remember, what we learned here is with depth, the temperature decreases. That is a general trend. But there are certain enclosures, certain seas where you have different anomalies recorded. For example, Sargasso Sea, Red Sea, Mediterranean Sea, Sulu Sea. These have anomalies which have been found. Mediterranean Sea records 24.4 degrees C at the depth of about 1829 meters, whereas the Indian Ocean has only 1.1 degrees C temperature. So remember, Mediterranean is far higher than what is at the same depth Indian Ocean, right? This is an anomaly. And then anomalous conditions are also noticed in various other seas. So if you observe this Sargasso Sea in the Northern Atlantic or this Sulu Sea just southwest of Philippines, this is where you see that particular depth have more temperatures than normal. So these enclosed seas of higher latitudes register inversion of temperature as well. And that is important point to remember, that there is inversion of temperature in the seas as well, like we learned about inversion of temperature in the atmosphere. So this is important to remember.
So now, when we have learned in details the temperature distribution in the oceans across the globe, now in the sessions to come, we'll be talking more on the salinity distribution and density distribution. So stay tuned, stay safe, and all the best wishes to you.